these are the men of steel. They work the very rim of the volcano, tending the rivers of molten iron, which feed Australia's demand for metal. Cars, fridges, building materials, hammers and nails, buckets and spades. Virtually every requirement of modern life flows at 1600 degrees Celsius down this hellish river.
Why do we need these men? Because we have reached the crossroads, and we must choose carefully, for there is no middle ground. One road leads to wealth and power. The other, just as surely, leads to poverty.
Argentina and Australia once had more in common than just being countries Europeans considered on the wrong side of the globe. Both were great rural economies that by 1920 could compete with each other for the title of richest country on earth. Both were countries of city dwellers whose people still saw themselves as pioneers. But by 1950, in barely the space of 30 years, the sun had set on Argentinian glory, and its inhabitants, unlike Australians, became familiar with poverty and despair. Argentina had turned into a developing country. At the turn of the century, there was nothing Australians couldn't afford. Ahead, we were the richest people on earth. Our life expectancy was the longest in the world. Envied by other nations, we were one of the first to give people a basic wage, pensions, and the vote to women. Today, our rank has dropped. 16 countries lead us in wealth. After Mexico and Brazil, we are per head the largest debtor nation on earth. The lucky country used to describe a country that had struck it rich on the land. But the countries that have struck it rich today are the ones whose exports are brimming with good inventions and ideas. If Australia has missed the boat, is it because we don't know what to do with our ideas and inventions? Or didn't we have any to begin with?
Since way back, Victor has always been first with ideas.
The motor mower was one of Australia's great ideas. Turning grass into lawn was the slogan. The world liked it and bought it. It was an Australian innovation born in the kitchen of Mervyn Victor Richardson. Out of a peach tin, a rubber band and a motor, it became the weapon for Australia's suburban pioneer. With interest from his neighbours and their neighbours and our overseas neighbours, an Australian export industry was born. And the Hills Hoist gave Australia a new and distinctive landscape. But that's not all we invented. The pop-top can is an Australian innovation. So is the wine cask. Our building industry gave the world brick veneer, ready-mixed concrete, and the self-erecting crane, which now constructs most of the world's cities. George Shepherd made millions, reinventing the wheel. His caster is an Australian innovation. The torpedo was invented by an Australian, Lewis Brennan, at the turn of the century. It cost the British Admiralty £100,000 to buy his idea. But it cost Alan Bond a lot more for this seagoing winner, that famous Australian keel. We've always been good at coming up with good ideas. Back in 1928, we were the first in the world to introduce a flying doctor service. A service that was possible because we'd invented a pedal-powered wireless.
Sadly, the good stories are few, and the tales of missed opportunity are many. With our good ideas and a strong manufacturing base, we would still be the richest country on earth. That would mean free education, free medicine, and no unemployment. But what happens when you have good ideas and no manufacturing base to back it up?
I think the worst scenario is that we don't wake up to our problems, that we go on living off future income, and that in 20 or 30 years' time, we'll suddenly wake up and find that we're the poor white man of Asia.
The world's first television broadcast may have been a very coy song in 1933, but it was Baird's experimental transmission in the 20s of the world's first television star, a wax dummy, that made it all possible. Or was it? Few Australians realise that it was an Australian, Henry Sutton of Ballarat, who thought up the idea in the first place. He published his idea for the mechanical transmission of television way back in 1895, calling it telephane. But he was too busy inventing other things to do anything about it, like the light bulb. But unfortunately, Thomas Edison invented that just 16 days earlier, over in the United States. But the curtain could have opened on a great Australian industry even earlier than that, because it was James Harrison, a Melbourne publisher, who invented what every home now has, the refrigerator.
In the 1850s, he produced a series of machines for making ice. Now, the first one he made using ether as the refrigerant, because he'd noticed when he'd cleaned his type, he found that the ether became cold, very cold, and the type became cold. So why shouldn't he use ether as a refrigerant fluid? And he did. And that produced a ton of ice a day, quite a commercial amount. And he put that on the market. Well, now, such is the cussedness of human nature that the connoisseur said, your ice is not nearly as good as the ice we import from Maryland in the United States. They used to take ice from lakes and saw it up and put it in cork line holes and send it to Australia. Harrison's ice had little bubbles in it, and they didn't like those bubbles. The ice from Maryland's much better, they said. So, like every other inventor, he had to put up with all kinds of stupidities from the general public.
It was this stupidity, this lack of faith and confidence in Australian ideas and products that Harrison fought against. But he couldn't win against the great Australian belief that things from overseas must be better. Public apathy eventually ruined him. One 100 years ago, Hugh Mackay's invention of the sunshine harvester made him the most powerful industrialist in Australia. The machine that he'd built in his own farm shed was to employ thousands of workers in one of the largest agricultural machinery companies in the world. But this achievement was brief. He was refused protection against the cheaper imported machines of the United States. Ruined without protection, Sunshine was taken over by Massey Ferguson, a multinational corporation. And the original Mackay harvester that had made it all possible was taken to the tip.
These things happened over 100 years ago. Surely we learnt the importance of manufacturing since then.
Here is an undertaking of which every Australian should be intensely proud. Where 3 years ago hundreds were employed in aircraft production, today tens of thousands toil. A country which did not produce even a motorcycle is today making a modern torpedo bomber with twin engines delivering between them 2,400 horsepower. And every nut and bolt, every instrument, every tiny detail of equipment in that plane is Australian made.
By the 60s, we were building the Mirage jet. But when that program ended, the Australian aircraft industry was shot out of the sky. Only a few trainers were built, along with Jindabyk, now a rapidly dating decoy plane, but once an Australian first. Instead of designing and building her own aircraft, Australia, with her mineral-earned pocket money, went shopping round the military world.
25 years ago, there were four countries who were very expert in space. They were the United States, the Soviet Union, the United Kingdom, and Australia. We had the largest rocket range in the world. We were exporting the electronics and the rockets themselves. We were manufacturing in a big way.
Successful launch, and immediately information beams in from all sources on the progress of the flight. The 92-ton rocket soars on its journey, a short but significant step for Australia and her Eldo partners on their way to outer space.
And what did Australia do? Australia decides that it is going to give up. And at the time that we were having NASA visiting us to find out how we built our radio telescopes, when we had other people copying our rockets, we decided, let's go away, let's give this game away. What we also did was to give the competition a tremendous assistance, because we sold off for bargain prices the antennas and the systems that we had. We've given our friends around the world a marvellous opportunity, and that they weren't slow to take up on. They are in there where we should have been.
One of the countries in there where we should have been is Sweden. The Swedes, with half our population and wealth and a tenth of our landmass, do not consider themselves too small for space. Sweden, once a partner with the Europeans in the S range, is now the owner and controller of a station that launches its own rockets and controls many of the world's satellites. But the profit in Swedish space activities is not only measured in krona, it is measured in youth. In Sweden, a solution to unemployment and dying industries is finding new ones. This high school at Kiruna, an iron ore town near the space range, was once the pit stop for miners' kids before they took up the profession of their fathers. Now, a space technology course in the senior year gives the youth the opportunity to stay in the area, preventing the slow death of a once fast-growing mining town. Such initiative could have been useful in Australia had we expanded our space industry.
Now, this is not the first time we've done this. Let me remind you that we were the third nation in the world to produce a digital computer. And we began to get a little nervous that here we were and the rest of the world, the big boys, weren't really up with us. So we got a committee to come, two people from Britain and one engineer from Australia, and say, should we stay in this technology? And the committee thought and decided, no, really what Australia should be doing, and the committee was quite clear in 1955, stay with wool, stay with mining, and let other countries like the United States and the United Kingdom provide the world with computer technology. 1955, we made transistor radios. But another committee decided that maybe we as a nation should stick with vacuum tubes, those old valve things that we used to use that you now see in museums. We stayed there while the rest of the world went into transistors. It seems to me that really we shouldn't be asking competitors to make decisions for us.
50 years ago, surely we've learnt since then.
Reports by short-sighted committees are not confined to our past. The Myers Report, commissioned in 1980, concluded, the ability of the government or people of a small country such as Australia to influence the development of new technologies and their use in the world is probably extremely limited. Such attitudes are not a thing of the past. In 1985, having spent years and millions of dollars developing this training plane, the A-10, Australia bailed out. We lost our nerve and chose a trainer from the Swiss corporation, Pilatus, that did not even fulfill the original brief for a side-by-side trainer. It would seem that today, Australia can't even build a training plane, let alone a sophisticated jet fighter. In Sweden, the highways of industry are not just for cars. The Swedish car builder, Saab, has been designing and selling its own sophisticated jet fighter, the Viggen, for years. It is a unique design that can take off from normal highways. In an age where we like to think of ourselves as an advanced industrial nation, why is it that the flight recorder, invented by Dr. David Warren to save the lives of millions of future air passengers, languishes here?
The Department of Civil Aviation, when pestered for some statement as to whether they could use this idea, came up, and I quote their words, Dr. Warren's invention has no immediate significance in civil aviation.
Today, no one doubts the value of the flight recorder. But at the time of its conception, The resistance by government departments was such that a federal court judge had to order the installation of the box in all Australian aircraft. After 10 years of battling, it looked like Warren would see his invention finally get off the ground.
Sure, the law was passed, but when, again, the Department of Civil Aviation considered how they were going to meet this law, they chose, for reasons which we can only speculate, that they would ask an American firm to develop a recorder to do the job. Ours was flying, had been tested, proven in their aircraft, it could be modified to meet any requirements, and not one has been made in Australia, bar the one that we now have in the museum.
That was the 80s. We've got a new government now, and they would never let that happen.
The city became the natural site for an ironworks. And in 1915, operations were commenced by the Broken Hill proprietary with one blast furnace.
They betrayed us, they betrayed the workers, they betrayed everybody.
In what's been described as a kick in the teeth for Newcastle,
this is, of course, a boardroom betrayal
revealed it will shut down its main plant in the steel city within 2 years.
It feels like summer's taken.
No,
the BAP blokes reckon they've got a bit to do yet to get on par with our neighbours up north. And I don't reckon they're going to disappoint it.
2,500 jobs will go when the blast furnace finishes its last campaign in 1999. But those cuts are only part of BHP's plan to reinvent its steel division. The company is looking for cost reductions of well over $500 million in steel. That means more change and more job losses.
Australia's future depends on a strong and healthy steel industry.
BHP's decided that it wants to be offshore and it wants to be a miner. It wants to dig things out of the ground in places like Chile and it wants to sell them into other markets other than in Australia. John Prescott owns about 2 million shares in BHP.
2 million?
2 million shares.
What did he make the other day?
Well, it's a simple calculation. The share value went up by about 50 cents. So on Tuesday, when 2,500 workers lost their job in this city, John Prescott's personal wealth went up by $1 million.
That's obscene, isn't it?
Well, there's lots of words probably harsher than that that have been used around this town to describe it.
Here in Queensland and around the country, they're putting their money where their heart is. And no fair dinkum Australian will argue with that.
Hey, there's not a cloud in sight. It's as blue as your blue goodbye. And I thought that it would rain the day you went away.
Australia must decide and decide now. Do we continue to ride the sheep's back into oblivion? Or do we choose prosperity and build and maintain a strong manufacturing sector?
Hey, does it ever make you wonder?